another episode of Who Said Photography. We have an exciting show for you guys. I'm really, really happy to be doing this one. If you've been following us lately, we were talking about color theory for photographers, and then we did another one on the histogram on your camera. So this is the next evolutionary step that we're going to take. It's part of post-processing. We once again have Blake Rudus back online, and he has developed a zone system. And we're going to discuss the zone system. It opened my eyes up again, and it's changed my workflow and my understanding of how to make great images. So we're back with Blake again. So happy to be back. Blake, how are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Absolutely perfect. So this the zone system that you've designed, where did it actually come from?
It came from like a long time of not really knowing what I was doing and trying to understand how to do everything better. It really kind of developed from better understanding black and white images and black and white post-processing that then developed into how I edit my color images. And the idea was that in the very beginning, I didn't know what black and white conversions to use. I had no idea what those black and white conversions were doing to my image. And once I got a black and white image converted, I really didn't know how to control the tones in the image. So there came a need for me about 4 years ago to explore this idea of the old darkroom photography. Because when I was a kid in high school, I studied under, I didn't really study under him. I kind of say he's one of my mentors, even though I never met him, but Ansel Adams, like most of us, I've read all of his books, have all of his books, and a couple of his books pointed out how to see tone, and one of them is called the Negative. He made a three-part series called The Camera, The Negative, and The Print, and these three books are probably, even now, for digital photographers, are like the culmination, I think, of what photography is. A lot of times when people say, Blake, who do you learn from now? I still learn from Alfred Stieglitz and Ansel Adams. I don't really follow too many photographers in this day and age, and it's nothing against them. It's just that I think that there was a bigger study on photography back in the day with these individuals who devoted their entire lives not to digital post-processing and social media noise, but just diving full hard into the camera, what it does, and how to produce the best prints with the negatives that you have. So I at that time I said, well, you know, if this worked for me in the darkroom with the zone system, it's got to be able to transition at some point into post-processing in the digital world. So I did a lot of self-studying and self-exploration through his book, The Negative. Probably read it 7 times front to back, sticky notes all over the place, highlight marks everywhere. If you were to pick up my copy of The Negative, it's just, I mean, there's writing all over it. I became kind of like obsessed with it, I think. So what I was able to do, though, is I was able to really dive deep into tone and understand what tone is so that I could better understand my color images. So at the time, I thought I was just making better black and white photographs. And what it turned out is that once I realized that color is nothing more than tonal value, I was able to edit not only my black and white images better, but my color images better. And it is a very vast, it's a very big topic, the zone system is. But you can break it down into these little micro kind of sections. Like we talked about color theory before. You talked about the histogram last time. And really, this zone system spreads from understanding luminance values in histograms and seeing in black and white. Once you see in black and white, all your color images will be better.
Okay, so exactly when somebody's using the zone system, exactly how are they going to use it? What exactly is tone? We've gone through the histogram, and you've broken the histogram down into basically 10 zones. So most of us understand highlights, midtones.
What's the other shadows.
One? Shadows. God, this is like the third time I've done that. Most of us understand that, but that's only three. So in your system, you're breaking it down to 10 distinct areas. Now, within your system, again, we don't have to use all 10.
Right, so, and it's 11. So zone 0 is black, and then 1 through 10. Zone 0 is black, and 10 is white. So you actually have 11 whole zones that you can edit in. And for the long time, I actually used those 11 zones to edit my images in. but I've since gone to a 5-zone breakdown that uses zones 0 and 1, 2 and 3, 4, 5 and 6, 7 and 8, 9 and 10. But what that really is if you look at luminance value, and luminance value is anything from 0 to 255. So we've heard that many times before. 0 to 255, 0 being black, 255 being white. So that gives us 256 total tonal value tone points, right?
Yep.
Well, if you take that luminance value, which is also our histogram, the bottom of your histogram with the thing that's going like this, that's 0 over here and 255 on the right, 0 on the left, 255 on the right. You can break that down into very distinct zones. So for every 22 points, so 256 divided by 11 be anything like 22 or something like that, for every 22 points spread, that's a zone. So you can actually select a very distinct area in your image, make a mask for it, and make an adjustment to it. And that modifies your zone. Now, where does this whole zone thing kind of come from? We have to throw back to Ansel Adams and talk about zones in general to begin with. Because our camera, typically, if you tell your camera to spot meter something, you're basically telling your camera, hey, you, make that thing that I spot metered for zone 5. That's why if you spot meter for what's outside a window, everything that's inside the room is going to be really dark, because you're telling your camera that everything outside should be zone 5 equivalent, so everything else has to adjust and get darker. Now, if you tell your camera that what's in the room is zone 5, then it's going to make everything that is outside much brighter, and then everything inside more visible. So that was the whole concept behind the zone system in the camera, and deducing what you make what zone and how you shift it. So if you're focusing in the shadows and spot metering for the shadows, those shadows are going to be zone 5. So then your exposure is probably going to drop a little bit, be a longer exposure in order to make those shadow areas brighter. In the process, you push everything else down the line. So that was the idea of getting the zones right in the camera and metering for a certain area of the scene that you're shooting to tell your camera what zone 5 is, so that when you got your negative, you can go into the dark room and you could make your print from there. That was the idea of zone metering or getting the zones right in camera so that you had something good that you could process later in the dark room. Well, now this is actually the flip side of that. I still do a lot of stuff in camera because I need to get the best exposure in the camera, but I do my zone editing afterwards. So instead of just looking at what's outside of zone 5 or inside of zone 5, I can actually break down the image from zone 0 being the darkest darks to zone 10 being the brightest brights and everything in between, and have a mask on a curves adjustment layer that allows me to only adjust that one zone that I'm trying to work on at any given time. So what it is it's extreme control over the entire editing process. Now we know that in Adobe Camera Raw, Lightroom, that we have what? We have exposure, we have highlights, shadows, whites, blacks, and contrast. And those are our 6 main adjustments for those areas. And some might even say that, well, you know, the shadows adjustment is basically your zone 1 through 5, right? Well, kind of, but you can't see it. Adobe Camera Raw doesn't tell you what a shadow is. It doesn't tell you what a highlight is. It doesn't tell you. So you're really kind of blind editing. I mean, you have an idea that a highlight is a highlight and a shadow is a shadow because the algorithm picks it for you, but you can't physically see what it is that's being selected with that zone inside of Adobe Camera Raw or Lightroom, so to speak. And white point and black point are the white and black sliders are actually a little bit different than a zone because they actually push in your histogram left or right, depending on which way you push the slider. So you don't really have the control over your images that you think you do, even though you have a lot of control over your images in Adobe Camera Raw and Lightroom. So for me, when I first started diving into the system, I was like, wait, I already have a lot of control in Adobe Camera Raw, because that's usually where I edit. But now I've got a ton of control when I'm using the zone system because of just how much I'm able to do with it.
Yeah, okay, so you're breaking down the whole system into, well, I use your 5s instead of using the 10. 10 is just way too much control over all of it. But that's a great way to control your tonality. by breaking it down, but how is anybody else going to fully understand? So how are you adjusting the tone?
I'll go ahead and I'll share my screen now and show you kind of an image that already has the zones set up along the bottom. So what we talked about with our zones 0 through zone 10, here you can kind of see the chart on the scale. So zone 0 is 0 through about 24. Zone 1 is 25 through about 51. And these are just estimates on your luminance values of that pixel value. So one of the things that I always stress individuals learn before you start even editing a color image is understand tone. The reason why I say that is because with color, there's like, I don't know what, like 12 million colors that are possible in an image at any given time, depending on what color space you're working in. And the bigger the color space, the more possible colors you have in there. Well, when you think about things in terms of tone, you have 0 and 256. You have 256 possible points that you can edit, essentially. That's what we're saying there with your scale. So your scale goes from like a 12 million scale to a 256 scale. So number one, it's already easier to understand how image processing works when you think in the form of tone, even for color, because all color has tonal value. So the way this works is it used to be a series of actions. You could open up your actions in Photoshop and press play on your zone system. But now what it is it's actually a palette, like a panel that opens up in Photoshop. And you have your zones, your individual zones up here. So this one, if I click this, it's going to give me a selection for what zone 0 is. And I can press Alt or Option, and I can look at my image here and see that this is selecting zone 0 and a little bit of zone 1. It does that on purpose so that we get a nice blend into each zone. But if you were to select something like this one, these ones are zones 0 and 1, zones 2 and 3, 4, 5 and 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10. This is what I call the condensed zone system. So the idea here is that I usually start with a condensed zone system, and if I need just zone 5, I can come up here and just get what the selection is for zone 5 instead of having to get really minute and do 11 zones. I used to do an 11 zone process on every one of my photographs, but what I noticed was that it can actually be a little bit detrimental when you're working on such small slivers of zones, depending on how much information is actually in your image. So after doing some modifying and you know, like we always do, we go back to the drawing board. I went back to the drawing board and came up with a condensed zone system. So the idea here is when you press play on the condensed zone system on this extension, it's going to go ahead and make all of your zones for you. And if you once it's complete, if you press Alt or Option on any one of the masks, that's basically telling you what that zone has selected. If it's black, there will be no effect whatsoever to that area. If it's white, transitioning into a mid-tone gray, those areas will be affected by anything that you do. Now, these are all on a curves adjustment layer. So if we were to go into this curves adjustment layer here, I'll close this panel down and move this up and down, you can see that my darkest dark areas are now getting some contrast added to them, whether I add that contrast in by making those darkest darks darker or bring it up by making those darks lighter. So I can get in there and I can just maybe bring that down and darken up those dark areas, maybe going into zone 2 and 3 and see what I have there to see if I want to brighten up some of those areas. But the potential here that a lot of people don't realize now is that, so let's say we go into Adobe Camera Roll and you go into the highlight slider and you move the highlight slider, you have more highlight or less highlight, and that's it, period, right? With this, we don't have just more highlight or more shadow, or less highlight or less shadow. We have, give me a little bit more shadow in the shadowy areas of those shadows, okay? And the reason why is because we have this zone, this is zones 2 and 3 now. If you look at the way a curves adjustment layer works, this is the darkest darks of that area. This is the midtones of that zone, and these are the highlights of that zone. So essentially, I'm saying zone 2 and 3, which control those areas, I can now say make the darkest areas of that darker, but keep the midtones and the highlights the same and don't affect those quite as much as you affect the darkest dark areas of zones 2 and 3. So this is where you get complete and utter control over every part of the editing process when it comes down to your image. Zones 4, 5, and 6, if we press Alt or Option, we can see exactly what it is. I know that this is predominantly going to be the sky and a little bit of the mountains in the background. And it's on a mask so that if I come in here and I maybe brighten those areas up and I don't want it to affect any area in the foreground, I can always paint things in with my brush tool set to black. And I don't have to affect those areas, and I'm only affecting maybe the sky there. So the whole process, it seems, a lot of people say, well, that seems like a ton of work. And I usually tell them, well, it's layer intensive, but not labor intensive, okay? It's one of those things that while you do get quite the palette of things building up in your layers palette, it's not really that difficult to do. You can actually expedite your workflow, because you understand what it is that you're editing. You know exactly what it is that you're editing. So a lot of times when we talk about workflow, it's, you know, the question is, well, you know, Blake, do you do this on every single one of your images? And the answer is really not necessarily. This is one of those processes that I reserve for my extreme fine art pieces. If I'm going to print something, you better believe I'm going to use its own system on it. But if it's just a casual image that I'm going to put up on my website that maybe shows a photo document of what I did in Arches National Park 2 weeks ago, then I'll probably just process it in Adobe Camera Raw, get it to a nice look, maybe add some of my artistic effects to it, and put it up on my blog. So the way the workflow works is that you get the image right in Adobe Camera Raw first, even out those tones so that you can expand on those tones with the zone system. So I used to spend anywhere from, I'd say, probably 45 minutes to an hour on any of my images, and now I'm kind of down to about 7 or 8 minutes, depending on how extensive I go with that finishing touch part of it. But the idea is to get the tones correct before you move into color. Get your colors correct before you move into effects, any artistic effects, and then you're set up and ready to go beyond that with extreme artistic effects or finishing touches. So it is a process, but when you study it this way and you break it down this way, it's efficiency, because you're making deliberate edits. The edits that you're doing are extremely accurate, because it's not just slamming sliders around. You understand what aspects of your image are being edited, and it's efficient. It's extremely efficient, because you know exactly what it is that you're going to do with that image. There were times where I would bring a photo into Photoshop and I'd say, okay, what are we going to do with this? And I'd just sit there and I'd go from one plugin to the next and I'd bounce around hitting presets. And like an hour would go by and I wouldn't be happy with it in the end. And I'd probably just delete what I did or maybe never show anybody. So it got me down to a point where I actually get a solid, concise workflow that I use on every one of my images. I no longer say, Blake, what are you going to do with this photo? I know for a fact I'm going to modify tone. I'm going to get it just right, going to get color right, and then I'm going to go into my artistic or finishing touches.
Well, that's exactly it. You know, like you said, I used to spend an hour. Huck, I'd be there for 3 or 4 if I liked the image, and then decide on how I want to edit it and what I have to do. But I never broke it down into the 10 areas. Again, it was always highlights, shadows, and there we go. I can't remember those three again. That's the hardest thing. Mid-tones. Like, come on, man. I'm going to have to write that down. And those are the things that I would break it down to, and those are the only things that I would adjust. But with this system here, even with the five zones and the way they work, I've still got a little bit more latitude and a little bit more control, which is great. Now, in this system here, you actually have a tone checker.
Yes.
Again, what a great way of doing it. Once I've done my toning, I actually have a checker that right. will allow me to see how my tone is actually happening. Do you want to go over the tone checker? Because the tone checker is something throws me off, but I'm never quite sure what I'm trying to do with it.
Well, it's something so kind of simple but effective. And how it works is in the panel here, if we go into contrast checker, what this was designed to do was it was designed to teach me to look at my image in terms of tone. So when I look at this photograph, because this is basically a curves adjustment layer on top of a gradient map. Okay. So that gradient map is a form of black and white conversion that maps out the appropriate tones to the tonal value of the color. which is extremely important to understand. Because if you just go and you take a hue saturation adjustment and slam down the saturation, you're removing the colors from those colors. So if you've got two colors, blue and yellow, that have the same saturation value, they now become the same tonal value, even though that color blue is a much darker color than the color yellow. Okay, so the gradient map appropriates the tone that should go with that color value. So if you look at this image, let's look at the gradient map first. Just to kind of give you an idea, this gradient map is a gradient from black to white. It's just a black and white gradient, nothing special. Watch what happens when I turn it into this one. We now get kind of like a cyanotype look on our photograph, because we're now telling anything white to become this color blue, anything black to become this color blue, and anything in between to fall in line with where it would be in the gradient map. Okay, so when we take this gradient map and turn it back to black and white, that's how we get the best tonal values for the colors in our image. So what the contrast checker does is the contrast checker is basically designed to let you see the contrast in your image. Do you have a black point? Do you have a white point? You know, when you're looking at color, it's very difficult to tell. But a lot of times putting a gradient map on there will tell you right away which areas of your image are a little too dark, which areas of your image are a little too light. So if you turn on this curves adjustment layer here, you can actually get a what's called the targeted adjustment tool right here. You can click on that bad boy and click anywhere. And that's basically going to say that these are the darkest areas of our image. If we bring these up a little bit, turn the gradient map off, that's going to be kind of our correction for these areas getting so dark. Well, if we don't want that to happen to the rest of the image, we can just bring down those midtones a little bit over here, so that we've now taken those dark areas and made them a little less dark by bringing up that curve to make them a little bit lighter. So it's just a way that you can check your work, essentially. With this image, because it is already kind of a complete image, you're not really going to see a difference. But if I do something like this, let me just go ahead and delete all this work. Let me get a contrast, a brightness contrast here, and drop the contrast. And I'll duplicate that. And then now if I do that tone checker, the contrast checker, you can see the difference here is that everything seems like it's all on the same value of gray. Okay. So if we were to go into that curves adjustment layer, we can use that curves adjustment layer to make our darks a little bit darker, make our lights a little bit lighter. And when we turn off that gradient map, we now have a better image just by looking at the tones in our image, because we know that we need certain things to pop off the page a little bit more. Now, the thing that I'm actually about to do a tutorial on this on Friday, there's a blend mode called luminosity, because you'll notice that when we bring this up, we also bring up some of our color. We change this to luminosity. Basically, what that's saying is that our colors are not going to be affected by this tonal adjustment. All we're going to get is tone applied and no color. If I change this back to normal, you'll see that the color comes along with it, because as you see up here, this is affecting the red, green, and blue channel collectively. If we change that to luminosity, it only affects the tones of those channels. Okay, so that's a little bit more on the advanced level there, but that would be like an image out of the camera or something like that. And just with a simple tone curve like this, knowing what we know about black and white images and how we need a black point and we need a white point, you can even bring your white point over a little bit if you want to, bring your black point over a little bit if you want to, knowing that we need a white point and a black point for our eye to rest on is extremely critical, because the eye will naturally gravitate towards highlights first. So in this image, the viewer is going to go to this waterfall and this cloud and bounce between them first and then transition around the rest of the image. It's because we kind of get sucked into those lightest light areas. Then we go towards saturation, and then we go towards detail. So and that's why you'll notice that even in soft focused images, It's not the soft focus that we really are bothered by. It's typically going to be the highlights, or if there is color in it, the color that's going to grab us first, because our mind will naturally fill in details where details need to be. So it's our job to make sure that the colors and the tones are right, and then detail can kind of come in after there. So soft focus images don't really bother our mind too much, and actually we find soft focus images to be beautiful. But man, if there's a blowout, our eye will see it right away.
No, yeah, no, I understand that as well. As soon as you had a blowout, it's like, yeah, there's something wrong here, which is pretty well difficult to shoot when you're doing waterfalls anyways, not to blow them out, especially if you're trying to make them a longer one. Yeah, okay, so here's my question on that one then. If I've got the color checker, the contrast checker in place, can I still go back and change my tones?
Oh, yeah, yeah, because if you turn that on, it's just basically going to be a baseline for you. So whether you have that curve on the top or the curve underneath, okay, it doesn't matter, because that gradient map, because of the way the gradient map works, it's not a snapshot of a black and white image. It's kind of like a, what's the word for it? A dynamic black and white image. As things change underneath, it's going to show you their whites and their blacks changing on top. So it's not like you've taken a snapshot of your image and made it black and white.
Yeah.
You're getting a gradient map for whatever's underneath.
Okay.
So if you change anything underneath, that's what my favorite black and white conversion is, actually not anything that is in any program or plugin. It's to take a gradient map and put a hue saturation underneath it, because that allows me to change my colors underneath my tones.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, that makes sense. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see you learning stuff all the time. I never even thought of that one. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Okay, so one more thing on toning your image. And that's going to be dodge and burn.
Okay.
So dodge and burn is one of those things where when I understood it, because people like said, okay, you either dodge or burn. But there's a technique to doing dodging and burning, which again, I just learned the last little while. It's not taking that whole complete item, a tree in the woods. And if you want to make the tree darker, you know, if you want the whatever item you want to make stand out, you dodge and burn around it. You don't dodge and burn the item. Watching you, because I've watched a couple of your demonstrations on dodge and burn, you're very heavy into dodge and burn. Often, to me, when I watch it, sometimes I think, what the heck is he doing? He's got no rhyme or reason.
Well, you think so, but you know, the thing is, I think you have to go back. Did you ever do any darkroom photography?
You know, I haven't. I probably spent maybe about 2 weeks, actually, in a darkroom. And that's probably...
Did you do dodging and burning in the dark room?
Well, we did dodging and burning, but that, you know, I was a young man then.
Yeah, so was I. But I remember it. It is burned into my brain. I hated dodging and burning. My biggest fear was if my instructor would say, your print's good, but I really think you should dodge this and burn this. Maybe give this 3 more seconds and that 4. And I'm like, oh, I hated it. I hated it. It was so painstaking. Because you go through this process, and for those who don't know about dodging and burning in the darkroom, you have an enlarger. The enlarger forces light through the negative that goes onto the piece of paper that's your print. Well, just like in the digital age, certain things need to be lighter and certain things need to be darker. You can't just say, okay, put this much light, 20 seconds, let's say, onto this piece of paper. Some parts are going to need 15 seconds. Some might need 16 seconds. Some might need the whole 20. So what you did under that enlarger is you made a cardboard cutout. And you just cut out your print, or you'd make a cardboard cutout, and at 16 seconds, you would dodge and move back and forth like this real slow. And if you stayed, don't stay,
because
you're going to have a hard edge.
Hard edge, yeah.
It's just like the soft edge brush that we have in Photoshop and the hard edge brush. Well, if you took that piece of cardboard and someone started talking to you in the darkroom, and you're like, oh, yeah, I'm going to go hang out this weekend. Oh, crap. Well, now you got to redo your whole print, because you don't want to put it through the fixer and the stop bath and the developer and just to find out that you have a hard edge on your image. So the reason why I dodge and burn now, and I dodge and burn on every photograph, is that it's easy. I can dodge and burn in 10 seconds. And if I don't like it, I can delete it. It's not that big of a deal. So the idea of dodging and burning, and when you think about it from the darkroom perspective, was, you know, you would probably dodge all of the sky, or burn all of the sky, not just one little cloud up there. But the control that we have these days to say, you know what, I don't want to dodge just the whole sky or burn the whole sky. I just want that one little cloud to be a little bit more puffy. Well, look at this. I can just, 2 seconds and I'm done. You know, so for me, dodging and burning is a very integral piece to the whole puzzle of photography, digital photography, because it doesn't take an hour plus all of your darkroom time plus, you know, the losing paper. And if you had a bad, you know, dodge and burn photo, you pretty much just can that print. You know, it's, we don't have to do that now. So a process that would have been painstaking, that could have taken 3 to 5 hours when you're waiting for the dry times on your photographs, now takes 3 to 5 seconds. You know, so, and dodging and burning isn't, it's kind of subjective to what the individual wants. So what we've talked about big tone adjustments that globally adjust your whole image. We've talked about local adjustments that target a very specific object in your image. Now we need to talk about the subjective nature of dodging and burning, which is, I'm going to go in with my Wacom tablet and I'm going to just very slowly kind of paint the areas that I want to be darker or the areas that I want to be lighter, not by something that was selected globally and not by something that was selected automatically with a zone. So really what happens is you become a painter of light. It's your creative freedom with that image. There's so many things about dodging and burning that just go beyond the technical aspect of it. I mean, that's you as the painter of light, deciding what's light and what's dark. And I think that's just such a phenomenal concept.
Well, I think so too, because like I said, for the longest time, I didn't do a lot of dodging and burning because there's so many concepts to understand. And this zone system breaks it down. And once you understand the zone system, again, you can get through these things in 7 to 10 minutes so quickly. And the workflow and everything is done in a methodical way. And that's, you know, that's what I like about it. And a good point, the dodge and burn is up to you on what you want to dodge and burn. But again, it gives me a little bit more creativity on what I want to gather the the viewer to see.
Yeah, and that's the big takeaway there. And there's so many ways to do it. I mean, I show one way in the Zone System Express knowledge base, I guess if you want to call it the education, but I'm coming out with a course in a couple of days. It's all about dodging and burning. It's an hour of dodging and burning, and it's got a panel with an extension for Photoshop that does it all pretty much kind of for you. I mean, it sets you up with all the different three of the ways that I use to dodge and burn, because there's so many different ways you can dodge and burn. It's not just, oh, well, you know, use the dodge and burn tools or use this technique or use this technique. There's many different techniques out there.
No, that's exactly it. Your technique, it was totally different from the way that I was used to doing it. Both of us would use a 50% gray layer, but I would just regularly use a 20% and I would use a brush. You're actually using the dodge and burn tool, which is, again, different way of doing it. But I kind of like that because just holding the Alt button down is the only finger I need, Alt and change. So it works rather well. But it gives you that much more control of what we wanted the contrast to be and to attract the viewer's eyes into that part of it. So to me, but the thing I learned in the last little while was where I want to dodge and burn is not the full item, is the edges of those items. And that was a game changer, again, for me, for dodging and burning. To me, I was just making things lighter and darker, but that's not what we really want to do. Is we want to do it at the edges of the tree or the boat or whatever the subject is, the train or whatever it's in. And that's one of the things I want to get across to these people. It's like, yeah, we can dodge and burn, guys, but there's a reason and a system actually for it. We're not just going around and, you know, I want to make the grass lighter and there we go, we're all done. And no, we're not doing the whole item. We're looking for these edges to grasp onto to gather that more contrast and more control over it. So that's probably the first part of it. Your saying goes tone, color, and effects. And this whole system, again, you have a whole system on color that runs along the same as the tone. Once we've got it toned, we then get to play with the color on what we want to do on bringing our colors up and down. Do you want to jump into that for a little bit? Because we've only got a few minutes left.
Sure. Yeah, so after the zone system kind of came about, I was thinking about a way to have the same kind of control over my image, but not with tone, but with color. And when you do it like this, it's absolutely phenomenal, because I'm going to share my screen here. What you break your image down in a very similar way that you would with tones, but it does it with color. So in over here, we go from the tone tab to the color tab, and you have all these pretty little colored buttons up here. What this is called the color zone system. And then these are kind of like analogous color zone systems. So we talked about color theory quite a bit. A lot of the color theory knowledge that I've given in the past is all centered around the color zone system. But the idea is that it's going to break down our image into red, yellow, green, cyan, blue, magenta. The thing that's different here is that, yeah, you might say, well, I can do that in Adobe Camera Raw, Lightroom, Photoshop with the hue saturation adjustment layer, and you certainly can. But if you alt-click, this shows me what red is. This shows me what yellow is. This shows me what green is. This shows me what cyan is. This shows me what blue is. There's some other things that are kind of happening in the background here that make this a very effective tool. So it's not just a color selection for the color cyan or blue. There's actually some algorithm stuff happening in the background to make this work. But let's just go into the color yellow here real quick.
Yeah, but with this, I still have control over that mask.
You do, yeah.
And that's a big thing. Although the system is picking out these colors for me, if I want to pick out an individual tree that I want to gather your eyes on, I still have the option to modify the mask. Sorry, Blake. It's just one of those. No. I just had to bring that up.
Yeah. So, I mean, you have the mask here. You can do any. It's a mask. You can do anything you want with it. You can paint out this area. You know, you can do anything you want now because you have it on its own individual mask. But the beauty of this is that you get the tone of the color yellow now. So now we're talking about color in terms of tone, and we can tell that color yellow, and this is something you can't do in Adobe Camera Raw or Lightroom. You cannot target the color yellow. You can target the lightness of it because we have hue, saturation, and lightness, but you cannot say, I want the darkest colors of the color yellow to get darker and the lightest portions of the color yellow to get lighter, or I only want the lightest portions of that color yellow to get darker or lighter. That's something that you cannot do. And so you see here, this is a very micro adjustment just for that one little spot up there, rather than the image as a whole. The other part of that is really quite interesting, let's just do this real quick because I kind of like the way that looked. If we go in and we break down the RGB channels, we can go into the color red, color green, color blue in the individual channel, and we become a painter on our digital image. Okay, so we can go into the color green, and we're saying now make the color yellow a lot more green, a green that we would never want to go to, or tone down the green that's in the yellow already and make it a little bit more magenta. This is where we can also come in and we can go into the blues and say make it a little bit more yellow in those highlight areas by bringing this down. Because we talked about inverse relationships, we talked about color theory. When you talk about color theory and inverse relationships, this is the blue channel. But the blue channel actually has two colors in it. It has more blue, or reduce the blue by adding its complement, which is yellow. Okay, so that's where we start to paint kind of with colors here in our own individual colors. If we go into like the blue channel, and then, or the blue color, sorry, we can make that blue a little bit darker, maybe brighten up the lightest portions of it, and maybe make it a little bit more blue by bumping up the blue there. Might even want to come into the reds and add a little bit of cyan there to get a nice little cyan color in that sky. And now we've changed the whole look and feel of the image by making the sky a little bit more blue. Where this really comes in is if we go up here and we, let me default my colors to black and white, make a gradient map on top of this. Now we have a gradient map on top of the color zone system. This is where we can get into our blues and start to get those Ansel Adams style blues in our skies by really bringing down, making that blue a lot darker. Maybe we come in and clip it over till it gets real dark and then bring this down. Now we start to get those really rich, dramatic blue skies. If we take that gradient map off, it's not a very beautiful color at all. It's actually pretty nasty. But with that gradient map on there, we now get control over our black and white images that we never had before because we have control of our color that we never had before.
You know, and I'm watching this and I'm thinking, yeah, 7 minutes, I'm sure you could do things in less than 7 minutes because, like, you're making changes there that were segments that were very, very quick.
And if I'm not teaching it, it goes by a lot faster. I mean, you know, when I bring an image in, and the thing is, though, is that I don't want to mislead people. I never want to mislead people and say, when you buy this, or when you get this, or when you get this type of control, you can do this in 7 minutes. You have to understand these concepts. And that's why I don't like to just give someone a tool and say, have fun. I give someone a tool with 5 hours of education and say, okay, you need to learn this first. Then you can do this. It's like, have you ever seen Braveheart?
Yep.
And Braveheart, he goes to his uncle and he's like, well, I can fight. He's like, yeah, well, I want you to use this before you can lose this. And it's like, so he's telling him to use his brain before he picks up that sword and starts fighting in war. It's the same concept here, is that we have to get the education and the knowledge before you can get to the point of editing an image in 7 minutes.
Yeah, understandable. Okay, so where can people get a hold of this?
This is on, if you go to F64 Academy on the right sidebar on the blog, there's a thing over there to take you over to the zone system. It's actually sold on my shop, which is at F64Elite.com. If you go to the shop on F64Elite.com, it's there. It's just in the shop area. You can buy the education, or I did have a way to just buy the panel by itself, but I don't like people getting it without the education, because it's just one of those things.
I would suggest people don't buy the panel by itself, because you're missing out on the knowledge that goes behind it and what you're actually trying to do. That's the reason I'm so thankful that I got the whole piece. I've got the complete package. It gives me all that information. I often, you know, I'm sorry, but you're on my TV more often than I'm on it. I've watched the color theory for photographers at least 4 times.
Wow.
I've watched that at least 4 times. For me, that's where I am. It's so important for me to understand that. Like I said, my whole workflow when I bought this panel changed. I think it's well worth the money for it. Any questions I have, because when I bought the panel, I get 1 month of free credit on F64 Elite. People on there were very helpful. It's a great system. It's changed everything that I've ever looked at, really. So I can't say enough about it.
I'm also open to, if anyone has any issues, email me, Blake at F64 Academy. I have a inbox zero is my mission every day. I do not like to have anything in my inbox. So when people email me, I try to get back to it as soon as possible. So, you know, that's my goal and that's my hope, is that if people have questions about these types of things and anything that we talked about here, I mean, if I can't answer it in an email, I probably already have a video tutorial that I can show you that's on YouTube that can kind of give you some of these concepts and some of these ideas. A lot of the more advanced stuff that we talked about today is behind that wall of the course, though, because I'm teaching things that is, I would say, I mean, I've been painting since I was 5, you know, with watercolors. I consider that as part of my career of painting. I was learning some very essential things at 5. But I've been painting for a long time. So taking that painting knowledge with color theory and pulling it together with digital photography so that you can learn how to be an artist in this process too. I mean, it's not necessarily just being a technical expert. If we're just technical experts, then we're just technicians of our cameras and technicians of Photoshop. And there's nothing really romantic or sexy about that. But when you get this level of knowledge, you become the artist photographer. You can take your images to a whole other level that you've never really been before because you understand all these concepts. One thing I haven't put out yet that I'm actually working on as of right now, as soon as I get off with you, I'm going to continue recording, is a whole thing about finishing touches. I've talked about tone and color for to make things technically perfect. But what about tone and color for effects, tone effects, color effects, effect effects? And all these things kind of go in. Once you start to get a knowledge of tone and color, you're going to see things in totally different ways. You're going to be able to pick up somebody's print and say, I know exactly what you did with this.
Oh, yeah. No, I agree, because I'm doing that now. I'm going, yeah, I know how he did that. Next.
Yep.
Don't like that smell.
But things
get out of here.
Just astound me are now like, oh, I can do that. You know, I think that's the cool part about it, is that, and there's no end to it. You know, I'm always learning stuff. We're always learning stuff. I can always learn more. I'm always reading books. Now I'm reading things about advanced composition from the painters. You know, because if we learn composition from painters, then we're much better as photographers.
Well, yeah. Well, there's no end to it. For anybody that is not willing to learn and continue to learn, I think that's kind of like a downfall.
Right.
There's so many things. It's not just using the camera. Now the darkroom is so much in the world of Photoshop, and Lightroom is so much more accessible. If you've got the time, then that's great. You know, unfortunately or fortunately, I'm retired, so I've got the time.
Nice.
Not everybody's got that much time to sit there. It's phenomenal. But again, the zone system, it opened my eyes up. We got to go. I got to let you go back to work or get some stuff to get done. It's opened my eyes up. I truly, truly, truly believe in it, and that's why I'm holding shows for you. I think this system, for anybody just breaking in, is going to help them immensely. Because the zone system doesn't, it's not only for landscapes, it's also for portraits. It's also for, I haven't used it for infrared, but I use it for HDR. When I do my HDR images, I use that. Any type of work that you're using for it can certainly help. And the more you learn, the more knowledge you gain. But again, I got to go.
Yeah.
Thanks for watching, guys. This will be, don't forget to hit the like button on our YouTube channel. And we'll see you next time on Who Said Photography?